ઓમ તો સરની આપણે ઇન્ટ્રોડક્શનની જરૂર નથી, કારણ કે સરને આપણે બધા તો ઓળખીએ જ છીએ, પણ એનઆરઆઈ પણ એટલા ઓળખે છે. મિસ્ટર દક્ષેશ ડી કોઠારી ઇઝ અ ટેક્સ એન્ડ ફિનાન્શિયલ કન્સલ્ટન્ટ. હી ઇઝ ધ સીઓ એન્ડ મેનેજિંગ ડિરેક્ટર ઓફ આશુતોષ ફિનાન્શિયલ સર્વિસીસ પ્રાઇવેટ લિમિટેડ એન્ડ જોઈન્ટ એમડી ઓફ આશુતોષ રબર પ્રાઇવેટ લિમિટેડ. હી હેઝ સ્ટડીડ બીકોમ LLB એન્ડ સ્પેશિયલાઇઝિસ ઇન ધ ફિલ્ડ ઓફ ઇન્કમ ટેક્સ, કંપનીઝ એક્ટ, ફેમા, ટ્રસ્ટ લોસ એન્ડ ઇનહેરિટન્સ લોસ. On financial front, he specializes in investment advisory, capital advisory and insurance advisory. He has deep knowledge and understanding about investments and financial services. He is involved with number of professional organizations. He possesses wide knowledge and experience on technical, legal and operational aspects of real estate as well. He has attended number of seminars and conferences on this subject and has enriched and sharpened his knowledge. He advises companies, trust, high net worth individual and non-resident Indians across the globe on financial and tax law matters. He regularly addresses different professional bodies and groups on subjects relating to investment, direct tax and financial services. He also addresses public meetings and seminars on macroeconomic issues. He is editor of monthly publication Dhan Vyavastha. His articles on financial subjects regularly published in newspapers. His interview was aired on ET Now as mutual fund industry expert in the program named Swatantra. He is a trustee to charitable trust and has been involved with a number of service projects of Rotary Club. He is a Rotary Paul Harris Fellow of Rotary International. He is a 360 degree versatile personality in the fields of taxation and finance, which makes him unique and truly one-stop solution for wide range of financial and tax related matters. I now request Sri Dakshesh Kothari sir to take over the session. Sir,
replying to your query that you pose, the secret is giving a nice introduction. It's nothing more than that. Chairperson of the Rajkot chapter of the Institute of Company Secretaries, my dear friend Mr. Nalin Ganatra, whom we have been associated since I don't know how many years, and ladies and gentlemen, what I could see in Mr. Gupta's presentation was that you had a long session of confusing and complicated provisions, and when it will come to this presentation, it is going to be fairly light and clear. The simple reason is that the laws in respect of taxation have been fairly settled now. As far as your company law is concerned, every day there are new amendments, new notifications and circulars and whatnot coming up, and every time when I talk with Nalin bhai, he would explain me something which is so complex, and in order to comply with it's still more complex, you know. For you to understand the provisions, it is fine, but then for us running a company to comply with those things, it's extremely complex doing business with those complicated provisions. Having said all these things, we will go with this presentation, wherein endeavor would be that when NRIs fund Indian LLPs and companies, what would be the implications insofar as FEMA and income tax is concerned. So the word which I have used is funding. These days what happens is that so many of the NRIs, it is not just contributing capital to the company or the LLP directly, but the contribution most of the times is through various routes, even otherwise than those structured routes. They could be in the form of a loan, they could be in form of a gift to the promoters. So, in one way or the other, if capital is bought to the company to do some business, then we need to look into and see that what could be the peripheral issues about it. The first thing which comes up in my mind is that, and we spend a lot of time interacting with the clients, regarding the fact that who is a NRI. No? Professionals and even the clients, they are utterly, let me use the word utterly, confused on the fact that who is a NRI. And in India, there are several definitions, several ways in which NRIs have been defined under different laws. So we need to completely understand that which definition of NRI would apply under what circumstances. The first definition is under the Indian Income Tax Act. Right? This definition is pretty simple till the time we make it complicated. Now, the reason is that a resident, a person is resident in India if he is in India of 182 days or more. This is the only definition which we need to take into consideration by and large. The reason why I am saying this is that anybody who is a citizen of India or is a person of Indian origin, this is the definition which comes into operation. All the subsequent and all the dissections further on of this definition would come into play for people who are not citizens of India or not persons of Indian origin. So, this definition that a person would be a resident in India if he is in India for a period of 60 days or more in the previous year and 365 days or in the four preceding years is applicable to only people who are not resident, who are not citizens of India or who are not persons of Indian origin. So by and large, all the non-residents and non-resident Indians that we are dealing with, the only definition that we need and take into consideration is this definition of 182 days. All those people who are out of this definition are non-residents. So, I am a resident of India because I am in India for more than 182 days in the previous year. Only then the further dissection of somebody being a resident and an ordinary resident and resident but not ordinary resident would come into play. So, if somebody is a non-resident, then we need not worry and need not go into all these details. Somebody who is a resident, then only there are two bifurcations of being resident and ordinary resident and resident but not ordinary resident. The highest scope of taxation is in this definition, which is resident and ordinary resident. The scope of resident but not ordinary residence in terms of taxation is a little less, and in case of non-residents, it's still much less. I am not going into that part. I understand that we have got some more and other more interesting things to follow. A person, as far as FEMA is concerned, FEMA defines a person resident in India who is residing in India for more than 182 days. But the most important thing is that it dilutes this definition of number of days. It says that it does not include somebody who has gone out of India to take some employment, some business or vocation, or the most important thing, that he has moved out of India for an intention to stay outside of India for an uncertain period. This is a very interesting definition, and so many of the people get confused here because this is a definition which comes into play insofar as financial transactions and banking is concerned. Here, to illustrate and explain, I am here before you today at around 6:30, but I am taking a flight to move out of this country tonight at 4 o'clock and tomorrow I will be out of India and there I am starting some business or I am taking some employment. Then I will become a non-resident under FEMA tomorrow. So it has no relevance in respect of how many number of days I stayed in India. 182 days, the definition starts with that, but it gets diluted with the fact that what is the intention of that person. So when I move out of this country and I am out of this country tomorrow in a foreign destination to take up an employment or a business, I become a non-resident under FEMA. So I might be a resident under the Indian Income Tax Act because I was for more than 182 days in this country in this financial year, but under FEMA from tomorrow I am a non-resident Indian. So this definition operates in respect of people who are in India. But then what happens to people who have never come to India? Who have never come to India, but basically they are people of Indian origin. Say I have a friend in US. His children have never come to India. Right? But they are children of somebody who was a citizen of India when he moved out of India or during these dates. So basically what is covered under this definition or circular of this OCI, Overseas Citizenship of India, is that somebody who is of Indian origin, say a child, a grandchild or a great grandchild of a citizen of India, or somebody who was eligible to be a citizen of India, who was a part of undivided India in earlier times, they are all considered eligible for being overseas citizen of India. And for the purposes of banking, somebody who is covered under FEMA was a citizen, and as I explained, and somebody who has never come to India, but he is a person of Indian origin by these standards, then that person becomes a non-resident Indian for all banking and financial purposes. To add to that, one of the concessions which has been given for overseas citizen of India is that a spouse of foreign origin of somebody who is covered here also is a overseas citizen of India. So my friend, as I said, if he married to somebody who is an American, still that American lady would become an overseas citizen of India. So all people, irrespective of the fact whether they have come to India or not come to India, if they are of Indian origin or they are spouses of people who are of Indian origin, they are called overseas citizen of India. One of the confusions which people have, so many clients have, is that what is my status under overseas citizen of India? I would like to make it very clear that overseas citizen of India is nothing but a certification or a card which clearly signifies that I am a non-resident Indian, one, and I would not need any visas till the time this card is valid to travel back and forth from India and abroad. So it is not that I have a right as a full-fledged citizen. There are certain jurisdictions in the world who allow two passports to operate simultaneously, and you are citizens, full-fledged citizens of two jurisdictions, two countries. India does not allow it. So if I am taking a US citizenship, I am taking a US passport, then I have to surrender my Indian passport. Overseas citizen of India card is just what I said, that it eases the fact to show off that I am a non-resident Indian, or my travel to back and forth from India becomes easy. persons who were ever citizens of Pakistan and Bangladesh, they are not eligible for OCI card. And for the purposes of banking, this definition under FEMA or eligibility under OCI card is something which operates. To add to all these things, different regulations issued by RBI and under various provisions of FEMA, they define a non-resident Indian or a person of Indian origin in a different manner. But if somebody has got an understanding of what is the basic definition under FEMA and under the OCI card, it is a little tinkering here and there of it. So, the next way in which people might get confused is under the Citizenship Act. So we have seen the definition under the Income Tax Act, then we saw the definition under FEMA, then we saw as to who is eligible for an OCI card, and now we are looking at that under the Citizenship Act, who are the people who are called the citizens of a particular country. Now all these definitions and all these regulations operate independently. As far as somebody who is a citizen of India, he can acquire citizenship by birth, by descent, by registration or naturalization. Citizenship is nothing but somebody obtains a passport of a particular country. So somebody can have an Indian passport, be staying out of India for n number of years. So he is a non-resident under the Income Tax Act. He wants to stay for an indefinite time frame out of India. So under FEMA, he is a non-resident. And the other way around, somebody having a British passport, staying in India with the intention of being in India for an indefinite period, is still a Indian resident under FEMA and under the Indian Income Tax Act. So all these definitions of different laws operate independently. Citizenship is something where I can contest elections, get a government job, get a support from a particular embassy in a foreign country because I am a citizen of a particular country. So all these things are completely distinct. So to sum up, income tax is something where the residential status is based solely on the number of days. It doesn't look at balance any of these things. FEMA looks at the conduct and the intention of the person. OCI card is something where persons of Indian origin, if they satisfy all those tests, they are eligible to be a person of Indian origin. And citizenship is something which somebody can acquire by applying it. So at any point of time, one should not confuse all these things. So many people, as I said in the beginning, they are confused on these grounds. Now the next part of dealing with these basic things is basics of taxation. And today these things have become very much prominent because in earlier times when we used to meet clients, they would be of the mindset that my Indian affairs are Indian affairs, my abroad affairs are abroad. Whatever is my income and whatever are my tax related compliance, I will do it abroad separately. It has no connection with my Indian incomes and Indian compliances. That is the way people operated for years and years together. But now the times are changing, things are getting integrated. The biggest of the economies, US, and several other economies, they have implemented FATCA as a regulation which will integrate and which will pave a way for seamless information to the tax authorities. For countries other than US, there is CRS, Common Reporting System. So that would also pave a way for seamless exchange of information. So now it is very much important that the whatever is the income of a person, the compliance has to be complete in respect of taxation. in order to understand what will be the tax liability the moment we interact with a non-resident Indian, we need to put this basic principle, which is a principle which is not just a principle under a law of a country, but this is the way taxation operates globally. Say, for instance, I am a person who is an Indian tax resident because I have been in India for more than 182 days in this year. So, the principle, the way it would operate is that I would be taxed in India in respect of my global income. So, I have my income in India, I have got some income in Dubai, I have got some income in UK, I've got some income in Australia, some income in US. So, when I am filing my Indian tax returns, I need to disclose and pay taxes on the entire global income, which is Indian plus, 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 everything. Now, all those countries from which I derived those incomes, they would say that you earned this income from our country. So, in respect of the incomes that you have earned from our country, you would be liable to taxation in our country. So, UK would say that whatever was your UK income, we will tax that UK income. Then, same with other jurisdictions as well. Maybe a Dubai would say that we don't have any taxation, it's fine. But all the countries where from I have sourced my income, I will be supposed to pay tax under the source rule. And as far as the fact that I am a resident of a particular country, a tax resident of a particular country, I will be supposed to pay taxes on my aggregated global income. Right? Now, the question that would arise in our mind is that I am paying tax in India in respect of my global income and I was already taxed in respect of my incomes which I earned abroad under the source rule. So, I would end up paying double taxation. In order to set the things right, India has entered into double taxation avoidance agreements with 89 countries of the world, wherein the income of a person who is a tax resident of one country would not get doubly taxed. How it will not get doubly taxed, we'll look into after a couple of slides. So, all the major jurisdictions of the world, India has got a double taxation avoidance agreement. Now, the principle insofar as double taxation avoidance agreement is that a treaty, a double taxation avoidance agreement is even called a treaty. Treaty overrides the local law. So, whatever are the provisions of the local law, say the Indian law, whenever if there is a treaty between two jurisdictions, then the provisions of the treaty or the local law, whichever beneficial, shall apply to the assessee. So, if the provisions, if I feel that I am comfortable with the provisions of that country, I will pay my taxes accordingly, or I can take I can fall back on the provisions of the treaty. For example, as far as the TDS rates under double taxation avoidance agreement, in respect of all these countries, they are much lower than the regular TDS rates which are prescribed in respect of interest income that non-resident in India, non-residents would earn in respect of interest income. So, if I provide a tax residency certificate of say a Singapore when I am holding my NRO account, then I can get a relief of getting with a TDS of only 15%, and if in case if I don't provide the tax residency, then I would be liable to 30% tax. So, under the treaty, whatever is beneficial is something which I can fall back on. Now, coming to what I said a while back, that what are the reliefs that I can get double taxation avoidance agreement. The way the double taxation avoidance agreements are structured between different jurisdictions, it can be an exemption method or a tax credit method. Under the exemption method, a income which is taxed under the source rule in some country, it would not be taxed at all in the residence country. So, if I have an income in Singapore and that double taxation avoidance agreement says that we would go for an exemption method, so something which is taxed in Singapore, India would say that, okay, we will exempt, we will not look into it and we will not tax it at all. The another method is tax credit method. The USA would say that you have your income there, India would say, okay, you need to aggregate that income. So whenever I am paying my Indian taxes, I will get a credit of the taxes that I have paid in USA while paying my Indian taxes. So my Indian taxes is 100, 10 I paid in US, I need to pay 90 out here in India. So that is a tax credit method. Now what happens if there are certain jurisdictions where India does not have a double taxation avoidance agreement? So in those cases, by and large, the tax credit method kind of a system works, wherein my incomes which are global would be aggregated, taxes whatever have been paid, I will get a credit, but I will not get a refund of the excess taxes that would have been paid under the source rule. Say, UK taxed me at 40%, India the maximum rate of tax is 30%. So when Section 91 operates, then I cannot get a refund of 10 rupees or 10% on account of the excess taxes that I have paid abroad. So this is the way the double taxation avoidance agreements, if they exist and they do not exist, it operates. Now, basics of NRI banking. It's just one slide, but there is a lot of incompliance in respect of so many of the non-residents when it comes to the banking part. A non-resident Indian is not permitted to hold domestic resident accounts. It can hold any of these accounts. I will not go into details of the features of these accounts. As you as professionals, you very well understand and you will be quite aware of that what an NRO, NRE or an FCNR account could be. A foreign national, a foreign student, a foreign tourist, what all accounts are permitted and what all accounts are not permitted is something which needs to be followed very, very precisely, because so many of the concessions, so many of the advantages which could be available to somebody needs to be availed only after if things are routed through appropriate banking. Now, just in LLP by non-resident Indians. You people are quite aware of the different formalities and procedures which I have been hearing at length, that whatever, you know, this filling up of these forms and uploading this and all those things. But the basic principle is that LLP registered or governed by Annexure 4 of this master direction, an NRI or an OCI can make an investment into that LLP. There are no limits on the capital contribution. The simple thing is that areas which are banned for investment by non-resident Indians, the LLP also cannot operate into it. Investments can be through NRE, NRO, FCNR or remittance. And disinvestment receipts would get credited to the NRO account. This is the feature, basic feature of an LLP which is governed by Annexure 4 of this master direction. Now, from thereafter, then we have got Annexure 6, wherein the difference is that investment in this LLP, this kind of an LLP can be made by person resident of India, person resident outside of India. So it is not necessary that he needs to be a non-resident Indian. It can be by any person resident outside of India. The business activities need to be business activities which fall under the automatic route of FDI, and there are no restrictions on the capital contribution. Investments should be through remittances, NRE, FCNR. There is no NRO. Disinvestments would get, can be remitted out of India or can be credited to the NRE or the FCNR account. Now, investments in unlisted companies by NRIs. Similar to the LLP provision, wherein persons resident out of India can make those investments. Here, in my understanding, the difference is that business is automatic route, or even under the approval route after proper approvals, investments from remittances, NRE, FCNR, sale proceeds, net of taxes can be remitted out of India and NREF or credited to NRE, FCNR account. Now, loans by NRI and PIO. This is, as I said at the outset, this is also one of the methodology by which funding is done on the projects or in businesses in the country. This is a method by which a close relative is what is the definition under the Companies Act, can from their NRE, FCNR accounts, a non-resident Indian or by way of remittances can give a loan not exceeding $250,000, maturity to be 1 year, the loan. So the difference and the important aspect in respect of this is that a repatriable loan can be given to a close relative by a non-resident Indian. Right? This is a repatriable loan. Monies can be received in forex and later on can be repaid in forex. So this is at times a major concern for so many of the people who are lending money, who are close relatives, lending money, that I am going to give you in dollars, you need to return me this money in dollars. Then, here non-resident Indians and PIOs can give to any resident individuals in Indian rupees non-repatriable loans, wherein the loans can be from remittances. The important difference from an NRO account, NRE or FCNR account. The difference out here is that these loans can be even from an NRO account. The loan period not to exceed 3 years, the rate of interest not to exceed 2% over the bank rate, the core rate. So, whenever this loan would be repaid, which is a non-repatriable loan, these monies would go to the NRO account. And from this NRO account, the last part of my presentation, one of the most important things, I understand that quite a few of them of you would even know about it, that $1 million per person per year, a non-resident Indian can remit out of India. And so many of the non-resident Indians are not aware of it. So here, prima facie, we might feel that this monies would go to the NRO account on a non-repatriable basis, but from this NRO account, under this scheme of $1 million, this credits in the NRO account can still be repatriated back out of India or can be transferred to the NRE account. Now, the next part is gifts by NRO and PIO to residents in India. Right? As far as gifts are concerned, it should originate from NRO, NRE account, either of them, or by way of remittance. One of the most important thing that a POA holder, power of attorney holder, is not authorized to sign checks or gift letters for the gifts. The gifts can even be into cash, and but the Indian resident cannot hold currency in US dollars. So gifts can be received by resident Indians. There is no bar, and these things we need to follow. Under the Income Tax Act, there is no gift tax in India, and whatever is received is taxable in hands of the recipient in excess of 50,000. This entire amount is taxable if it exceeds 50,000. But if these gifts are received from relatives which have been defined under the Income Tax Act, then they are tax free. So who all are covered under the Income Tax Act as close as relatives? Here the definition is in respect of a relative. In your company law, it is close relative. The definition is a little different. This is what is the definition, and the most important difference is lineal ascendants and descendants of an individual or of spouse. And for all, in respect of all these people, spouse of relative mentioned above. This is one of the essential difference between the definition under the company law and under the Income Tax Act. But in my mind, the most important part comes here. Whatever we saw that this gift would be exempt would be under the provisions of Section 56 of the Income Tax Act, wherein it says that somebody is your relative, said I receive a gift from my brother, he is a relative as defined under Section 56. But under the Income Tax Act, there is a separate provision which runs parallel with Section 56, which is Section 68, which also needs to be satisfied, and I lay a lot emphasis on that. So many of the people miss out on the implications of Section 68. Now, what is Section 68? Section 68, that any funds which are the book accounts explanation offers no explanation about the source thereof to the satisfaction of the debtor, then that income is liable to be taxed in the hands of the assessee. So the words are no explanation to the satisfaction of the assessing officer in respect of the nature and source. In order to discharge this burden, anybody who wants to, as I said, to discharge the burden under Section 68 needs to prove these three things which are very important. They need to prove the identity of the person from whom these monies are received. Then two, the credit worthiness of the person from whom these monies are received, and the genuineness of the transaction. Right? It might seem to be a little simple, but whenever there are amounts which are large in nature, it is really difficult, or it becomes really complex to satisfy and comply with these provisions. Credit worthiness of the person. Say my brother is drawing a remuneration of maybe 50,000 US dollars abroad, and he is giving me a gift of 50 lakhs of rupees. So it might be real tough for me to prove the credit worthiness of the person who has made the gift to me. We have seen in several cases, insofar as genuineness of transactions is concerned, these provisions even apply to gifts received in India. What happens is that somebody is having a balance of maybe 2,000, 5,000 rupees on a continuous basis, or maybe 25,000 rupees in his account. One fine day, there is a credit of cash deposit of maybe 10 lakhs of rupees, and the next day, these 10 lakhs of rupees go by way of a gift, and once again, that account has a balance of that 5,000, 10,000 rupees. So in those situations, to establish that this is a genuine transaction of gift might be very difficult. So these things have to be kept in mind, especially in case where somebody is trying to fund his operations in India by way of gift which are of large amounts. The reason why I am giving a lot of emphasis is that the rate of tax on such gifts is 60%, a special rate of tax of 60%, and when you add up everything, one would end up at a rate of 84%. So we need to be always aware that these provisions are taken care of whenever we make any kind of plans. Now, as far as the taxation part of the entire thing is concerned, in the initial slides, I will take some special provisions which are particular to non-resident Indians, which needs to be focused on. This is the way by which we need to compute the taxation as far as the capital gain is concerned. We are aware, as far as our Indian regulations are concerned, that from the sale consideration, what deductions which are available to is that the cost of acquisition, the index cost of acquisition, and thereafter whatever is the amount which is left over is taxed as capital gains. Now when it comes to case where somebody is a non-resident, then the provisions as it would apply is that there would be no indexation, but this relief for foreign currency fluctuation would be available to non-resident Indians. These provisions would apply only in case of shares and debentures acquired out of foreign exchange. So if there is somebody who is your client and has invested some amount into a company in India, where the proceeds to participate in the equity of that company has come in the form of foreign exchange, then these provisions would be something which will come into play. These provisions are not applicable to listed securities and mutual funds, equity based mutual funds. So this is essentially for companies which by and large we people deal with, wherein there is an equity participation by non-resident Indians. So this is the way how it works, that the sale consideration, which is as such received in Indian rupees, is to be converted into foreign currency used in purchase, right? So when I bought the shares of that company in which I have made investment, I bought those shares by paying that the consideration remittance in, say, US dollars, not in US dollars, say pound sterling. So entire calculation of foreign currency fluctuations would be available on the basis of that I will get a relief for foreign currency fluctuation in respect of pound sterling, right? So converted by foreign currency used in purchase, my purchase currency is pound, average rate of buy and sell TT, rate on the date of sale. So the date of sale, my sale consideration, despite the fact that it is received in Indian rupees, it will get transferred at this rate on the date of sale into a foreign currency. From that, the purchase consideration would also be converted as per the rate on the date of purchase into foreign currency. Cost of improvement, whatever if I have incurred, rate on the date of improvement once again would be converted into that pound sterling. Then expenditure relating to transfer also would be converted into foreign currency. And thereafter, whatever is the net gain
would be the gain in foreign currency. From this amount sale consideration, I am deducting all these things, and that is my gain in foreign currency. It would be converted into Indian rupees of the Indian rupees from the pound sterling, the at the rate of TT on the date of transfer, and the net gain would be in Indian rupees. So the entire methodology which I detailed was on the ground that I should not lose. If I am a non-resident, I should not be losing on account of foreign currency. So my entire gain would get converted into foreign currency, and thereafter whatever is the real gain, I would be taxed in India. Now further on, whatever is the gain, there are certain special provisions under Chapter 12, Capital A of the Income Tax Act. Here the difference is that the provisions of Section 48 on foreign currency fluctuations are available to all the non-residents, while as these provisions under Chapter 12A are available only to non-resident Indians. And these provisions are, as was detailed out in Section 48, investments in shares, debentures, and even deposits. These provisions are applicable to even bank deposits and deposits in a company which are given in convertible foreign exchange. As I said, it is available to non-resident Indians. For these purposes, the non-resident Indians are persons of Indian origin. And this is a flat rate of tax, which is a predetermined rate of tax, which is available to non-resident Indians, from which there would be no deduction for any expenditure or allowance that would be made. There would be no deduction under Chapter 6 or indexation under Section 48 that would be allowed. And if somebody is paying tax under this regime, then they need not even file the tax returns if appropriate rates of TDS have been deducted. The rate of tax in respect of the investment income of all those specified assets which I said, which are shares, debentures, deposits, government securities, the investment income, whatever is generated out of it, the rate of tax is flat 20%, but does not include dividends which are covered under 115 capital O, and the long term capital gain in respect of these transactions is just 10%. So anybody who is a non-resident Indian has made investments into those specified assets which I detailed out, then they can claim a fixed rate of tax irrespective of whatever is the prescribed rate of tax. Section 48, as far as foreign currency fluctuations are concerned, is the determinant of the amount on which this tax is supposed to be paid. Once again, one more relief which so many of the people, so many of the non-residents are not claiming is a very interesting thing which somebody can definitely look for, is say I am divesting my shares in a private limited company, I am a non-resident Indian, then if whatever is the gain that I receive would not be liable to tax if I make an investment into new specified assets. What are specified assets? Shares, debentures, government securities, and deposits even with a bank. So I receive capital gains on transfer of my shares in a company. If I just deposit the consideration of the amount that I receive into a bank deposit and hold it for a period of 3 years, and I should not be availing any loan against it, then that entire capital gain is tax free. Further on, if I invest this consideration partially, then proportionate deduction would be also available to me. This relief under this provision, say if I am holding a bank deposit and I want to go for that concessional rate of tax, and in between I become a resident Indian, then this concessional rate of taxation would continue to be available to me despite the fact that I have become a resident Indian till the time that deposit matures, right? And I might and might not opt for these provisions. Say these aren't provisions which are thrust upon a non-resident Indian. If they feel for some reason that I don't want to opt for this special provisions, they can opt for not electing to be taxed under these provisions. As far as the other rates of tax are concerned, on the first column is the type of income, taxation levy for non-resident Indians, and the TDS rate, or as people say abroad, as a withholding tax. And I have put this asterisk out here, which says that this rates of taxation, to add to that, would be the surcharge and the cesses, which will be the slide at the end of this details of the rates. As far as salaries are concerned, then whatever is the normal rate is the taxation levy, and the TDS is also at the normal rate, means the slab rate. Then when it is rental income, then the rental income which has been received or the annual letting value, it will be taxed at 30%, and the withholding tax or TDS is at 30%. One of the most important things as far as LLP is concerned, so many of the people are under the impression that whatever are the provisions for resident Indians, wherein we are not supposed to make any tax deduction at source for interest and remuneration which has been paid to partners, when it comes to non-resident Indians, one needs to make a deduction of tax at source at the rate of 30%. Whatever are the profits of a partnership firm or LLP, they are exempted, and hence there is no provision for TDS. Then if it is a professional income or a business income, then the levy of tax is at normal rate, which is the slab rate, and the TDS is at the rate of 30%. In case of immovable assets, including agricultural land located within specified area. So whenever there is a sale of an immovable property where the seller is a non-resident Indian and the buyer is a resident Indian, then different provisions of tax deduction at source operate. These things are very much observed in non-compliance, because so many of the people who are buying, so many people who are advising those buyers, they are not aware of it. So whenever we are buying a property from a non-resident Indian, the rate of tax for TDS when we make the payment of the consideration has to be 20% if it is a long-term capital asset, and if it is a short-term capital asset, it has to be 30%. Here the most important part is that the rate of tax is not on the capital gain. It would be on the entire consideration. Say if I am buying an asset worth 1 crore of rupees, an immovable property worth 1 crore of rupees, then if it is a short term capital asset, then I would be required to make a deduction at the rate of 30% on the consideration amount, which is 30 lakhs of rupees. And if it is a long term asset, say the period of holding by the seller is more than 2 years, then my rate of deduction of tax will be 20%, which is 20 lakhs of rupees. If I feel as a payer that this is an exorbitant rate of withholding tax or TDS that I will be going for, then the payer has to obtain a certificate under section 195(2) from the income tax authorities, showing that this is the amount of tax, which is an actual tax, which is supposed to be paid in respect of the monies which would result into capital gains on this transaction, and please let me allow to make the deduction only to that extent. But there I need to approach the assessing officer if I am a payer and obtain a certificate. If it is to be obtained by somebody who is the recipient, then they have to approach under section 197 and obtain a certificate that I am going to receive this money, but allow me to receive this money at a lower rate. So this is something which is very important. The liability is upon the person who is making the payment. So this needs to be kept in mind. As far as unlisted shares are concerned, the period of holding is 2 years. Short term is normal rates. Long term is 10% without indexation. And these are the rates of TDS. Interest on private deposits, the normal rate, slab rate, and 30% is the withholding tax. And dividend on shares, there is a dividend distribution tax of 15%, we all know. The one of the most important thing is that as far as non-residents are concerned, they are not taxed at that additional 10% even if the dividend exceeds rupees 10 lakhs. The provision which has been enacted a couple of years back, wherein if I am receiving dividends and I am a resident Indian, then I will be subjected to an additional rate of 10% of tax if my dividend exceeds 10 lakhs. This provision is not applicable to non-resident Indians. These are the rates of surcharge and cess, which I mentioned in the asterisk. The deductions for non-resident Indians are governed by section 195. So 195 is a section which is a little peculiar section, which is a little distinct from other provisions of the Income Tax Act as far as TDS is concerned. Under section 195, the liability for deduction of tax is on any person. As far as so many of the other provisions are concerned, the liability of deduction of tax is, say, to a firm, a proprietorship concern if it is required to get its accounts audited, or a company. But when it comes to section 195, when I am making a payment to a non-resident Indian, the liability is to any person. If I am buying a property in my individual capacity, then I need to make deduction of tax at source, despite the fact that I am just an individual who is buying that property. Then the payee has to be a non-resident Indian, and the liability is on any sum, right? So whatever is the sum paid to a non-resident Indian, the liability is on that any sum, irrespective of whatever is the constituent of those sums. And the rates as far as section 195 have been prescribed separately. As I said, under section 195.2, if the payer wants that a lower tax deduction needs to be deducted, then he needs to approach the assessing officer. And under 197, the recipient, the non-resident, can approach and get a certificate for lower and nil TDS. Under section 195, the basic principle is that any sum which is chargeable to tax is only liable to tax deduction. So the moment if an amount is exempted from tax, if it is exempted under section 10 or under any other provisions of law, it is an exempted income, then it is not chargeable to any tax. And if that amount is not chargeable to any tax, section 195 or any provision for tax deduction at source doesn't come into play. This is the last part of my presentation, which I during my presentation said that this scheme of $1 million per person per year is something which needs to be used very well, and anybody receiving any interest from an NRO account, any non-resident Indians, I tell them in my presentations that it is a sin to receive interest and pay tax on it when it is NRO deposits. Because all the NRO money can be converted into NRE, or it can be converted into FCNR, or it can travel out of India with a simple procedure. The basic precondition is that tax is due on those funds have been paid. Then a simple procedure by a chartered accountant needs to be followed, and after following up that procedure, we need to give those certificates to the bank. This transfer of funds is not subject to any approval. It is just after some compliance, which I said, which are simple compliances, those monies can be transferred to a NRE or an FCNR, or it can travel abroad. The moment those monies from NRO account are transferred to the NRE account, then interest on that very bank balance is tax-free. There is no liability of any TDS. NRE account, whatever are the monies which are stationed in that account, they are fully repatriable at any point of time, and it can be done comfortably at any point of time whenever the exchange rate suits. One of the most important thing which somebody needs to keep in mind is that this is just a relaxation given. This is not a promise. If I go into a little detail, say a balance in an NRE account or an FCNR account, it is a promise by the government that funds from these accounts can be repatriated back out of the country. But NRO account monies is something which is a relaxation given because India has very comfortable foreign exchange reserves, that it can be transferred to NRE, FCNR, or it can travel abroad. So anybody who has got funds in these kinds of accounts should take this opportunity, because it is not that the government is under an obligation to do it, it is a concession. That ends my presentation. So, if at all you have some questions, I will take it up if time permits. Otherwise, thank you so much. Thank you to the organizers and everybody for giving me a patient hearing.